Lineale! Huh. Maybe you don't have a good grasp on that, but I thought lineale had like a distinctive, kind of almost closed inflows. Oh, buddy!
Gee! Looking at the fruit?
Look at this!
Well, sometimes I joke, the state may pay me, but I work for the plants. Plants are the foundation of terrestrial life. They were around in one form or another long before modern humans ever stood upright or wandered out of Africa. They were here on these islands millions of years before the first canoe arrived. The Hawaiian flora is composed of many narrow endemics. Super rare species that may only occur on one island, one mountain, sometimes only one ridge or gulch. I'm thinking back here in some of these nooks and crannies, some of these cracks. You kind of see some nice steep sections over there. I bet the goats can't reach. I forget to coin the term, but it's called plant blindness. And people just don't interact with the plant world the same way they do with animals. It doesn't resonate with them. And until you start to learn which plants are native and which ones are weed, it all looks like, you know, greenery. And many people are visitors to the islands and they can't imagine that there's endangered plants because everything grows so well here. And it's because they, you know, aren't differentiating between the exotic plants that were brought here that have flourished and the threatened native plants that evolved in isolation.
Check on that ridge that goes up from the waterfall.
Yeah.
I can't quite get enough resolution, but there's some interesting looking like colors. I mean, it's probably just like euphorbia, but there's like a small shrubby little gray thing.
They evolved here with the many unique birds and insects, with the other native plants, and created habitats and ecosystems, which in many cases are even more rare or endangered than their individual components. For example, where is the dry forest? It's gone. It's never coming back. Not like it was. We may save some of the species that used to comprise it, but they're kept alive on human-mediated life support. Now, for the most part, we only have intact native vegetation communities at higher elevations, and even those are under constant threat from non-native plants and introduced goats, deer, and pigs. Where's all the low-elevation native forest? It's just a sea of weeds down there.
Ready, Adam?
Ready, Freddy.
We're looking for some indicator species that really help us identify healthy cliff patches. And once we get in close and we look for rare plants that may be growing in there, a lot of them are too small to see with the binoculars or while I'm flying the drone. So we'll go back and look at them in the lab afterwards.
Leaves are real small, it's hard to tell.
For some species, we can see them while we're here in the field, but a lot of things we don't uncover until we're back in the lab and looking at it on a big screen. It really helps to get that extra resolution. And out here, there's rain and sunshine glare on the iPad, so it makes it really difficult. Yeah, the steep cliffs are really difficult, but that's kind of what sparked the idea for me to apply drones and, you know, the difficulty of working in these areas, you know, really made it important to come up with some new solutions.
I wasn't really looking closely enough to check the gender, you know, because a young male.
I think the biggest thing that we see is the impact of goats, especially in Waimea Canyon with the dry habitat. Anything that's not vertical, the cliff, the goats can get into, and it makes it, you know, just much less biodiverse. Once there's these vertical surfaces that are in the shade a little bit more and keep the goats off them, that's where we really see a lot of you know, native plants and rare things.
Looks much drier, yeah, than last time.
There's many steps in this process that we've developed, and you know, from going out and trying to pre-scout with the binoculars and spotting scope, to flying the drone and collecting good imagery, to post-processing, and then also assessing our access to get down to plants, pick repelling sites, and then sending Adam and Scotty to go collect seeds.
And now we're really starting to explore the cliffs, getting out to these last places that no one's been able to see before, and we're finding these refugia, these last strongholds of native plants, some of them very rare, surviving on sheer cliffs wherever the goats can't reach them. Because wherever there's cliffs, there's goats, at least on this island. And what we're finding out there, where the animals can't reach, is amazing. Communities of native plants hanging on against all odds. It's magnificent and depressing all at once, because you see these little patches of awesomeness and just imagine, this is what used to cover all the hillsides and cliffs. Now it's just goat-grazed invasive grasslands, standing forests of aging, senescent trees without any seedlings or understory. But we're getting this little glimpse of what remains of the species that have survived in their diverse little assemblages on the sheer cliffs. Islands within the island.
No, I haven't lost hope at all. You know, for every successful seed collection that we're able to make, I think that's very hopeful. It's easy to just get overwhelmed with the scale of the threats that face the native biodiversity, but, you know, for every, like I said, you have these little successes, and so say for a certain plant that we find that no one's ever visited before, and we're able to, you know, capture its genetics more or less in the form of getting some seeds that can perpetuate it, well, that isn't going to be lost, you know, and it's just it's a matter of scale. And like anyone who works in conservation will tell you, you know, we're strapped for resources, and there's always limiting factors on manpower and budget. But the more people that get involved, the more people that take an interest in preserving, you know, native plants and that can make those connections to the larger, you know, indigenous culture, I think it's a win.
We see the incredibly unique flora of Kauai. Over 90% of the plants here are endemic, meaning that they occur only in Hawaii. And a lot of those are actually only on this island, on Kauai. And so when we're looking out at the sea of green, we're trying to identify all the plants that we're seeing. And especially we're looking for rare ones. So we work with the rarest of the rare, plants that have 50 or fewer individuals left in the wild. We have around 90 that are on our list. Of those 90, there are some that are what we call extinct in the wild, meaning that they no longer occur in their natural habitat, but we might have them represented in seed banks, in gardens, or in outplantings. So they're not totally gone from existence, but they just don't occur in the wild anymore.
The crocus scraping?
A lot of the time we're going to populations that we already know about, that previous botanists have found, and that we follow, check on year after year. And basically when we go to a site, one of our main goals is to collect propagules. So plants that aren't in protected areas, our goal is to get them into protected areas. So we try to collect seeds or cuttings or other spores, if it's a fern, other kinds of propagules. And then we work with partners in gardens and nurseries that can grow the plants out. And then ultimately we'll outplant them into protected areas. So that's kind of our main goal when we're visiting plants in the wild.
We have two different species of Phyllocedia planted here. So there's Phyllocedia electra, which is this one, and then Phyllocedia warana is the other one. And so the warana is the species that only has 3 individuals left in the wild.
We're at an outplanting site established about 2 years ago. We planted 2 separate species here, Philistia electra, Philistia warana. Philistia electra probably has 60 to 70 individuals left in really disjunct populations. Philistia warana, there's only 3 left in the wild. And we planted about 75 Philistia waranas here in hopes to get the seed bank going in the soil here.
What was your reaction today when you first walked in here after having not been here for a month or two?
Plants are doing insanely well. We're just so happy to see them. They're just these giant plants. They're still alive. They're a short-lived plant. They don't live very long. So just to see them in full seeding on the ground and just these giant canes going up the cliff, it's just incredible to see. It's just so beautiful. This site is just incredible, and that we can just keep inputting into these systems and finding more sites like this so that we can really recover some of these rare mints that are really on the edge with only 3 plants left. That's really something, to have now 75 plants here to 100 plants of these Philistia waranas, especially where there's, like I said, only 3 left in the wild. So really great to see 75 flowering, fruiting. We can collect from them and get them back into storage and get those individuals represented in the seed bank and get them propagated out again and just keep this cycle and keep this momentum going with these plants.
We chose this spot. But yeah, tons of fruit on this little spot here.
Nice.
What's involved for the PEPP program and all of you when you first go out and look for plants? It's kind of like searching for a needle in a haystack in some respects, isn't it?
Yeah, sometimes it's luck. You just at the right place at the right time and the lighting is right and something catches your eye that looks a little bit different in the composition of species. And sometimes it's a little bit more methodical where we look at old monographs and old books that other botanists had written and wrote and their encounters with this species and what other composition was around, what species were around this one particular plant. And then we can kind of go out and be like, this species was here, so this would be a good example of where this could be. And we really start getting our eyes and keying in on certain species that were when we're out in the forest, whether we're in a drier area, mesic area, or all the way up to the wettest forest. So we kind of, as botanists, have to understand the different communities. And it is really like finding a needle in a haystack. Gold is going to be where you find it. So sometimes we get lucky and sometimes we really make these really good educated guesses. But yeah, it really is like a needle in a haystack.
There are a lot of threats, and managing the threats is a big part of what we do too, especially with our partners. So probably one of the biggest ones is weeds. Introduced ungulates, goats and pigs, and then rats eating the fruits and chewing on the plants. Those are probably the biggest threats that I see.
Kind of a longer-throated flower. So the honey creeper would come in here, and visit the flower and get the nectar while pollinating the flower. But we're having to do that manually now. We do all kinds of work, carry heavy packs with all our gear. Sometimes we have to carry a pole picker with us to reach really high up in the tree to get fruit. Sometimes we have to carry air layers, which are basically propagation methods we use to take off the tree, and ends up being this big trash bag. And we're going through brush and arduous conditions through the ginger, through the blackberry, through the aluhe. These are all really hard tasks to move. Sometimes it takes us all day to move a football field. It can be pretty taxing just on your legs and your body. And, you just got to keep healthy and strong to really keep up with the work. We also do rappel work, which is pretty taxing on your body. It's kind of like a Stairmaster, but using, or like playing the drums, you know, or using all parts of your body and your mind and trying to be aware of what the dangers around you. And you know, you're going maybe 300 feet down a rope and you got to climb back up that rope, and that's a pretty far away, pretty far ways to just use your legs and your arms and climb up it. But you know, real rewarding at the same time, and just pushes you, you know, to work with these rare species and you know, have good field partners. It's just pushes you further and further your boundaries of what you think your limitations of your body can do.
Part of the Nepali Kona Forest Reserve, and we're going after some rare plants that grow on the cliff over here. So Scotty and I, the Plant Extinction Prevention Program, we rappelled down to them. Main goal, well, there's two things. We wanted to try and collect fruits of the Lysimachia scopulensis there, which is a new population. We've been here once before. We got collections from some plants. And this time, unfortunately, there wasn't any mature fruit. So we used these light mesh bags, and we bagged fruits on as many plants as we could, tag the individual plants. And then we'll come back next couple months and hopefully have, you know, mature fruit and seeds to collect. Koke tuai
geau ki kanoe. You gonna start it? I don't know, I guess we'll just go back and forth on the numbers.
Actually, it's a lot of fun. I mean, don't tell everybody that.
How what's the distance for them? Wow, that's pretty cool.
It can be a lot of fun, and you know, there's a lot of practice that comes with working at height, working with ropes, rappelling, that kind of stuff. So it's not like, you know, you just start doing that right away. Kind of got to work up to it. Get to know your equipment and
stuff.
They're
super hard.
Other than the fact that it's fun and a cool thing to do,
You know, these plants are really rare, and it takes, you know, it requires people who have a certain amount of dedication to kind of follow through, to be able to learn the flora, recognize what is common, and then you know when you found something rare, and then to actually do something about it, you know. So the first goal is just to get seeds or propagules in storage to prevent extinction.
I'm glad I don't have to do it. You know, it's definitely exciting work seeing what they're doing, and you know, I'm glad somebody wants to do that type of work. But for me, I like to fly the drone and stay up on the top of the ridge. We're using the drones to survey cliff habitat, looking for rare and endangered plants. And it's just a valuable new tool that we have to look at these areas that have never been explored before. It's like a treasure hunt, you know, we're out there always looking around, not exactly sure what we're going to find. And when we get something that's unique or hasn't been seen in a long time, it's really exciting. I think some of these areas would never be looked at unless drone technology had come along. It's just too steep and too large for humans to access on ropes. I mean, you're talking about thousands of feet of vertical distance that just really isn't possible with traditional rope methods. So.
Here we go.
Started out with some smaller drones, and we've slowly moved up to some bigger, more complex ones.
Right now I'm using the zoom lens to zoom in on some rare and endangered plants on the cliffside over there in an area where goats can't get to. So the zoom lens gets a little closer to the mountain so we can see the details of the plants. Rather than just photos and videos, we can put it into some software and create these orthomosaics where it stitches together images and it creates one giant image, and you can even overlay it into like 3D environments, and it helps inform ground crews to again search and destroy or whatever their target is, like wherever the target they're trying to access.
We're always looking at ways to expand the toolkit that we're using. We have a new grant with National Geographic that's looking at collecting plant material with the drone, so being able to get some seeds or cuttings from these plants that are inaccessible in any other way. And it may lead to keeping them from going extinct, so we're excited about that possibility.
We're looking at a few different species, PEPP species. One is Lismachia scopulensis that Ben Nyberg and Adam Williams had found on one of their drone excursions on a ridge right across there. Found about 35 plants. We bagged some fruit. Hopefully we can collect some fruit off these and get these in storage so they're secured. This is one little pocket of habitat that goats can't get to, so we have to go down on ropes and get to these plants.
This is the Lysimachia. I collected these to make a voucher, and the cliffs are kind of like this last frontier. Not only that, they're a refuge for plants that maybe used to be more widespread, but now only exist in these vertical environments where the goats can't reach them. These Lysimachia, even with these new populations that we found here in the canyon, there's still far fewer than 100, you know, in the whole world. So every individual does matter. It's, you know, that much more genetic diversity that we can hopefully capture and get represented in the new populations that we aim to one day establish. You know, it's really hard to protect them from the threats they face out here in the canyon. So it's not like in the near future we're not going to be able to provide meaningful protection to these wild plants, you know, clinging to a cliff face out in the middle of the canyon.
walk down there. It's not very
so what we're trying to do is just to keep these plants going, to perpetuate these parts of a greater whole. Sometimes it seems hopeless, and it's easy to get nihilistic about the whole thing. Well, what helps me is just focusing on the task at hand. For this one plant that we can reach, we can collect its seeds, and if we can get a good collection, bank some seeds in the seed bank, grow some plants to put back in a fence. For that one plant, it will live on, or at least its genetics will, even if it eventually succumbs to the threats around it. And for every plant that we're able to do that for, well, we're holding off the wave of extinctions. The scale of biodiversity loss that Hawaii has experienced is really quite staggering. And it's not just something that happened sometime in the past. It's happening before our very eyes. Goats eat every day. You gotta remember that. Heavy rains make landslides. A hurricane could come any year. But whereas in the past there were natural disturbances, now the environment is filled with so many weeds that when you get a major landscape level disturbance, the gap is just instantly filled with highly competitive non-native plants. With every patch of native plants we lose, it's gone. That stuff doesn't just grow back in the absence of active management. So that's what we're doing, active management. This is a day-by-day, week-by-week struggle to prevent extinction, to preserve species and ecosystems, in the hopes that the next generation will be able to do better than we have, and that we have something to pass on to them other than an island of weeds and escaped barnyard animals. The odds are not in our favor, but we're playing the long game with every tool we can get our hands on.